Thank you for listening to the Beginner Institute podcast. Please join us on Facebook at facebook.com/Beginner Institute, or you can join our email list at http://beginner.com and share these recordings with your family and friends.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Walikullin wijhatun huwa muwalliha. فاستبقوا الخيرات أينما تكونوا يأتي بكم الله جميعا إن الله على كل شيء قدير. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. The sisters can't hear. I don't know what to do about that. Sure. Inshallah. All right. Can they hear now? Can you guys hear now?
I hope so. Yeah.
Can you hear me now? Still can't hear me?
Still can't.
Yeah, if the sisters can go into the HIF class. Inshallah. Okay. Bismillah, salatu wassalam ala rasulillah. So we're on ayah number 148, and the conversation about the change of the qibla is continuing, and Allah says something that is basically a universal and a kind of axiom. It's a style of the Quran that Allah deals with a very specific issue, and in the middle of that specific issue He says something that is universal in nature. So you can draw a universal principle from it and reflect on it. And that's the expression وَلِكُلِّنْ وَجْهَةٌ هُوَ مُوَلِّيهَا, which has, I mean, the scholars have just had an extensive amount of commentary on that small phrase, وَلِكُلِّنْ وَجْهَةٌ هُوَ مُوَلِّيهَا. كُلْ in Arabic is usually, it comes with a مُضَافْ إِلَيْهِ, it comes with something that comes after it. And so there's commentary about why there isn't a مُضَافْ إِلَيْهِ here. And كُلٍ, لِكُلِّ مَنْ يُوَجِّهْ وَجْهَهُ, and so there's this, all this commentary, but for everyone who has a face to turn in some direction, min kulli ahli qiblatin, some say, for every person who belongs to a qibla, who faces in a direction. But really what Allah has said here by saying kullin is that He's talking about all people, all humanity, whether they follow a qibla or not, whether they pray in a particular direction or not. Allah is saying about everyone, likullin wijhatun. Wijhatun comes from the word wajh. Wajh, which means face, and wijhatun means a very particular direction. You see, the infinitives in the Arabic language, the masdar in the Arabic language is general, but when you add a tamarbuta to it, when you add around, then it becomes a very particular, specific thing. So for example, akl, akl is food. But if you say akla, tamarbuta, it's a very particular meal, or it's that particular meal that you had, that's akla. Or darb is hitting. But if you say darba with a tamarbuta, then what does that mean? A very particular hit. That one specific hit, okay? So now here Allah says wijhatun, a very particular direction. Allah is basically talking in majaz here and telling us that all humanity, every single individual, picks a goal in their life, a direction in their life, and they stick to it. And they just, everything they do in the end goes towards that one goal. Sometimes those goals are pathetic. Sometimes those goals are laughable, but sometimes those goals are meaningful. In this case, the physical direction of our prayer has been changed, but now Allah is using that to comment on our direction in life. That everyone, by the way, has a direction, not just in prayer, but in life, they have a direction. Towards huwa muwalliha, He turns towards it. He's the one who turns, and muwalli is interesting because it's both transitive and intransitive, lazim and muta'addi. So He turns Himself towards that direction, and He turns everything He has, everything, everyone around Him towards that direction too. In other words, not only do you pursue a life goal, you try to convince others that that is the way you should be living. You leave a legacy behind you. This is muwalliha. So now Allah has given us a direction, and He's given us not only a physical direction of prayer, but also a direction in life, guidance itself. So now He says, as a result, fastabiqul khayrat, then compete in good deeds. Compete in the few good deeds that Allah has given you to do, compete in them. Fastabiqul. So now, look at this imagery. First you have a goal, of course you face towards that goal, and now you're racing. Now you're racing towards that goal. And of course you can't race if there are different people heading in different directions, the race has to be in a unified direction. So now fastabiqul khayrat. Also, the immediate meaning, even though it has, the meaning is very vast, you know, it's all good deeds. But specific to the context, the deed is salat. Because the deed that is in direction of that, are the two deeds particularly, are salat and hajj. Right, that you should be competing in, or umrah. Those are the deeds you should be particularly competing in, but it's not restricted to those deeds. أَيْنَمَا تَكُونُوا يَأْتِبِكُمُ اللَّهُ جَمِيعًا. And then again, speaking of you know, direction, wherever you may be, wherever you may find yourselves, يَأْتِبِكُمُ اللَّهُ جَمِيعًا. Allah will bring you together. Allah will bring all of you all together, جَمِيعًا. إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٌ. Certainly Allah, He's in complete control over all things. وَمِنْ حَيْثُ خَرَجْتَ. So the question came by some Sahaba, and some tafsir is commented, even though you've already heard that the Qibla was changed, some Sahaba said, no, maybe the Qibla is changed specifically when we're in Medina, but what about when we're somewhere else? Should we still pray towards Al-Masjid Al-Haram, or should we stick to Masjid Al-Aqsa as usual, and this is only a hukum for example, Al-Masjid Al-Nabawi, or the vicinities in Medina? When we're here, we should pray towards Al-Masjid Al-Haram, otherwise we should stay the normal course. So now Allah tells His Messenger, وَمِنْ حَيْثُ خَرَجْتَ فَوَلِّي وَجْهَكَ شَطْرَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ. Wherever you may come out from, in other words, whatever place you may be in, and you head out, and you're out there, you have to face your direction now, you have to turn your face in the direction of Al-Masjid Al-Haram. وَإِنَّهُ لَلْحَقُّ مِنْ رَبِّكَ وَمَا اللَّهُ بِغَافِلٍ عَمَّا تَعْمَلُونَ. And certainly it truly is the truth and the purpose from your Master, and Allah is not at all unaware of what you've continued to do. So this is a reference to those who, in their solitude, even then, are kind of tempted to pray in the old direction. Like, yeah, I know Muslims told us to pray in this direction, but you see, you have to put it in social context. Some Muslims are very new, and their friends and their old family and associates are all Christians and Jews. And so sometimes the travel happens with them also. It's, you know, the situation in Medina is not like the situation in Mecca. The situation in Mecca was very tense. There's a lot of conflict between the Muslims and the non-Muslims. But the situation in Medina is not that tense. I mean, there is tension, but it's not as extreme as it was in Mecca. So the relationships are still intact. Family is still family. So someone's Christian, someone's Jewish, someone's Muslim, but they're still family. It's not like they cut them off completely like they did in Mecca. It didn't happen like that. Also, it didn't happen like that because the Muslims are not being seen as a weird faction. They're a significant population. In Mecca, they're a much smaller number, so it's easier to call them a cult or think of them as a fringe group. But in Medina, they're a significant population. They're a sizable population, and they have, you know, they've got it, you know, and now the Messenger himself, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is in a position of power, and so are the Muslims. So you don't think of them as outsiders. They're part of society now. And so in that scenario, when the Muslims already had so much of a life that they have spent with the Christians and Jews praying in a particular direction, the temptation would have been maybe when we're not in Medina or when we're by our old friends or old associates and they're about to pray in a particular direction, maybe we should just kind of stick to the old direction, not be the weird one that prays in the opposite direction. So Allah says, wherever you may be, pray in this direction to the Messenger, but He issues a warning to the rest, وَمَا اللَّهُ بِغَافِلٍ عَمَّا تَعْمَلُونَ. Allah is not at all unaware of what you continue to do. وَمِنْ حَيْثُ خَرَجْتَ فَوَلِّي وَجْهَكَ شَطْرَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ وَحَيْثُ مَا كُنْتُمْ فَوَلُّوا وُجُوهَكُمْ شَطْرًا. The same injunction a third time. And when an instruction is repeated like this, it is because it's not being internalized enough. You need to not let this go, you need to not forget it. So Allah Azza wa Jalla says, and for wherever you may come out from, turn your face in the direction of Al-Masjid Al-Haram. وَحَيْثُ مَا كُنْتُمْ. And wherever you may be, فَوَلُّوا وُجُوهَكُمْ شَطْرًا. Then turn your faces in its direction. لِأَلَّا يَكُونَ لِلنَّاسِ عَلَيْكُمْ حُجَّةٌ. And so that there may not be a case against you by the people may not have a case particularly against you. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا مِنْهُمْ. Except for those who do wrong among them. Meaning the case, what does it mean that لِأَلَّا يَكُونَ لِلنَّاسِ عَلَيْكُمْ حُجَّةٌ إِلَّا الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا مِنْهُمْ. Allah Azza wa Jalla is telling us, the Muslims basically at that point, that don't worry about it, nobody's going to make a case against you, nobody's going to blame you, except the only ones who will say something and criticize your new direction will be the wrongdoers, will be those who do wrong. And Allah already called them out in the previous discussion in the same surah, that they already know that that's the proper Qibla. They already know that. So the fact that they're criticizing it further reiterates that they are the ones that are in the wrong. فلا تخشوهم واخشوني ولأتم نعمتي عليكم ولعلكم تهتدون. Then don't be afraid of them, but be afraid of me. Don't be afraid of what they're going to say, be afraid of myself. فلا تخشوهم واخشوني. This is a very important universal statement. It'll repeat itself again, actually in even more dramatic form in Surah Ali Imran. And in this surah, before this same, a very similar statement was made to Bani Israel. Allah Azza wa Jal told them, وَإِيَّايَ الْفَرْهَبُونَ, fear only me, fear only me. As though there are others that they feared, and now Allah is telling them, no, you need to be fearing only and only myself. Now Allah is telling the Muslims, فَلَا تَخْشَوْهُمْ وَخْشَوْنِي, don't be afraid of them, be afraid of me. Don't be afraid of the people, be afraid of me. In Ali Imran, you know, the munafiqun spread a rumor that the people who have just had hurt the Muslims in Uhud are coming for a second run. So they said, in, you know, الَّذِينَ قَالَ لَهُمُ النَّاسِ إِنَّ النَّاسَ قَدْ جَمَعُوا لَكُمْ فَخْشَوْهُمْ فَزَادَهُمْ إِيمَانًا وَقَالُوا حَسْبُنَ اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ. The people are coming back and attacking you again. So, you know, you should be afraid of them. You should really fear the people that are coming because you're already injured in Uhud. And now they're coming to finish you off. We need to be worried about this. We need to be scared. And Allah says, in response, the believers, it only increased them in their iman. فَزَادَهُمْ إِيمَانًا وَقَالُوا حَسْبُنَ اللَّهُ. They said, Allah is enough for us. وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ. So now here, this idea of فَلَا تَخْشَوْهُمْ وَخْشَوْنِي, what should be explored about that is a society in which you have other religions, and in particular in the Madani phase, you have the Christians and the Jews, people of the book, who are people of knowledge and religion, and they are going out of their way to criticize the Muslims for their practices because they think of the Muslims as a new kid on the block. They think of them as the new, as deviated form of our original religions. And if you talk to Christian ministers, or even rabbis, and even in their textbooks, like encyclopedias of Judaic faith and things like that, a very common belief among them about Islam is that we're just a deviated form of Christianity and Judaism. We just mixed the two of them together and made up our own little thing. And that's what we are. That's how they see us. And that's how they teach their own to perceive us. That you copied, you know, you copied the whole, or a good chunk of it from the Bible, etc., etc. And when they say that, I say to them, why do you want to burn it then? So, but, you know, but anyway, that's a separate subject, you know. But this idea was already there, that this is not, you know, this is not a legitimate religion. So it's something that should be the object of ridicule. And in that scenario, what Allah is telling us is not to be preoccupied with what they think of your religion. Allah has already established the truth of our faith and the crime of them hiding the truth in their faith. Allah has already exposed that to us. So we don't need to be worried about what they say or what they think. We should just be afraid of Allah and speak the truth. فَلَا تَخْشَوْهُمْ وَخْشَوْنِي وَلِيُتِمَّ نِعْمَتِي عَلَيْكُمْ, and so that I may complete my favor upon you. So this وَلِيُتِمَّ نِعْمَتِي عَلَيْكُمْ is very beautiful. It comes again in Surah Al-Ma'idah. Allah Azza wa Jal revealed this ayah by most Mufassirun's account after the conquest of Makkah. الْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ وَأَتْمَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَتِي وَرَضِيتُ لَكُمْ الْإِسْلَامَ دِينًا. Right? They say, I completed my favor upon you. He says then, when Makkah is conquered, then he says, this day I've completed my favor upon you. Okay? This ni'mah. وَأَتْمَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَتِي. Okay? But here he says, وَلِيُتِمَّ نِعْمَتِي عَلَيْكُمْ. So I changed the qibla so that I may complete my favor upon you. لِي لَمْ الْكَيْ, you know, for the purpose. I've changed this qibla so that I may complete my favor upon you. And interestingly, when Makkah is conquered, then he says, I've completed my favor upon you. So right now he's turned your direction in it. So now it's begun, but a favor has been done, but it hasn't been completed. It'll be completed when the house is cleansed. But this is just the start of the process. And that'll be the completion of, you know, and of course that would mean that the mission of the messenger has come to a conclusion. When Makkah is cleansed, the house of Ibrahim, built by Ibrahim alayhi salam, is fixed again, and the Muslims are worshipping in it as they were supposed to worship, as per the dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam, then the favor of Allah is complete, meaning the mission of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam is complete. وَلِيُتِمَّ نِعْمَتِي عَلَيْكُمْ وَلَعَلَّكُمْ تَهْتَدُونَ, and so that you may be committed to guidance. And you know, this last part, you know, these fawasil in the Qur'an, these ayah endings in the Qur'an, oftentimes we look at them very casually, but just, I mean, if you look at the kinds of commentary our mufassirun make, there's such insights, such remarkable insights. This ayah about us changing our direction and us being guided is, you know, it directly relates, the immediate impact of it is salah. It's salah. And so the connection between our regularity in prayer and our commitment to guidance is made. in this part, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَحْتَدُونَ, so that you may be guided. And of course, the fundamental components of our guidance, the pillars of our faith, as described by the Prophet himself, عليه الصلاة والسلام, two of them have to do with the Qibla, as I just mentioned. Two of the aspects of our fundamental practical guidance on this earth has to do with this Qibla. So لَعَلَّكُمْ تَحْتَدُونَ. This is also important because Ibrahim alayhi salam in the same surah had made the dua, وَأَرِنَا مَنَاسِكَنَا. Show us our rituals. Show us the rituals we're supposed to have. And now we're getting ready for that. Which is why in this surah, now that Allah has established the change of the Qibla, now the subject is going to change in the coming ayat that we'll discuss next week, inshallah ta'ala. But what we're going to find is now we're ready to talk about Hajj. Now Hajj will come up. And we're getting ready to have that discussion. Of course, if the Qibla hasn't changed yet, you can't really have the conversation about Hajj. And especially as a right that Allah has, that Hajj should be performed in the way that He intended from back in the time of Ibrahim alayhi salam. That tradition of Ibrahim alayhi salam has to be revived. What tradition? Breaking the idols. Destroying the idols. He did that. And then the Messenger of Allah will get the opportunity to revive that tradition when Makkah is conquered and Hajj is made. Inshallah ta'ala, we'll continue our discussions on Surah Al-Baqarah next week. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-Hakim wa nafa'ni wa iyyakum bil ayati wa dhikr al-Hakim. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم كما أرسلنا فيكم رسولا منكم يتلو عليكم آياتنا ويزكيكم ويعلمكم الكتاب والحكمة ويعلمكم ما لم تكونوا تعلمون فاذكروني أذكركم واشكروا لي ولا تكفرون. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. ثم أما بعد, we are reading today from ayah number 151 of Al-Baqarah. The long discussion on the change of the Qibla has just come to an end, and Allah begins the next ayah with the word kama. And kama is an Arabic word a common translation would be just as, just like. And the purpose of this word is to compare one situation to another. The previous ayah, Allah Azza wa Jal concluded, وَلِأُتِمَّ نِعْمَتِي عَلَيْكُمْ وَلَعَلَّكُمْ تَهْتَدُونَ, so that I may complete my favor upon you. Meaning the changing of the Qibla is part of Allah completing His favor upon the Ummah, and we talked about the connection between that and the conquest of Makkah and eventually cleaning the house of Allah. That's part of completing the mission of the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. But Allah Azza wa Jal adds something else. He says that's one part of the mission. But another way of looking at completing the mission, one aspect of Allah's the mission of guidance being complete has already happened, and that is كَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا فِيكُمْ رَسُولًا, just as we sent among your midst a messenger. The fact that the final messenger has come to humanity, in one sense, the favor of Allah on humanity has already been completed. That aspect of it. What aspect of it? That a messenger has already been sent. That final messenger. That is the seal of all messengers. That concludes the relationship of wahi that humanity is going to have with Allah Azza wa Jal. That began with Adam alayhi salam is now coming to an end with this messenger that is reciting the ayat of Allah upon you. Then the phrasing that's used is the exact same phrasing that was found in the dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam. كما أرسلنا فيكم رسولا منكم يتلو عليكم آياتنا ويزكيكم ويعلمكم الكتاب والحكمة. That he, one يتلو عليكم آياتنا, he reads on to you our miraculous signs, our ayat. ويزكيكم, and he cleanses you, he purifies you. ويعلمكم الكتاب والحكمة, and he teaches you the book and the wisdom. So this four-step process in a different arrangement, and we talked about that in more detail in the first juz, when this first came up, that Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he asked for this dua, he put yuzakihim at the end, that he should teach them, he should recite the ayat onto them, teach them the book and the wisdom, and purify them. Purification was mentioned at the end. But now Allah is answering that dua. First of all, what's special about this dua is Allah used the second person, كَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا فِيكُمْ, you know, رَسُولًا مِنْكُمْ يَتْلُوا عَلَيْكُمْ آيَاتِنَا وَيُزَكِّيكُمْ, letting the ummah know that you specifically are being gifted with the response of the dua of Ibrahim, not anybody else. you are being addressed with this, these same phrases. He used the third person because he didn't know his children in the future, and Allah is telling us specifically, or the ummah, the followers of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that you are the fulfillment of the dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Just a very quick reminder, because these are important concepts, the idea of purification. وَيُزَكِّيكُمْ, He will cleanse you, He will purify you. He'll recite the ayat onto you. That's a very simple thing to understand. But the logical progression, by reciting the ayat onto you, the next thing will happen, which is that He's going to be cleansing you, He's going to be purifying you. When we talked about purification, I hope you recall there were two kinds of purification. There's a purification of the heart, and there's a purification of the mind. So we have to purify our characters, our mannerisms, our lusts, what we think about all the time, what we love, what we aspire for, how much remembrance of Allah is in our hearts. That's a kind of purification, to cleanse our hearts from things like jealousy and greed and, you know, anger and, you know, these kinds of things that can take over a person's personality. Part of the function of revelation is to give, you know, tranquility to our hearts, so that the hearts are not filled with these things, you know. So Allah Azza wa Jalla says, أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنَّ الْقُلُوبِ, for instance. That hearts become tranquil, you should know by the remembrance of Allah, and the best remembrance of Allah is Qur'an. So we're supposed to become that purified people in terms of our hearts, but also purity in terms of our understanding, intellectual purity. What that means is all these false concepts of, you know, God, all false concepts of salvation, what does it mean to attain success in the afterlife? All false concepts of good and evil. You know, people can have some idea of what the truth is, some idea of what their purpose in life is, and it's mixed in with some impurities, some of their own misinformed opinions. The purpose of revelation is to get rid of these impurities and to leave us with a pure, cleansed understanding of this deen. So that's really important, so that our hearts are pure and our minds are pure, our understanding is pure. That's yuzakkikum. And then thereafter, that when that foundation is built, once that foundation is cleansed, then there's the benefit of teaching the book. And the book implies also in Arabic phrasing, the law. Meaning the messenger's next function is to teach the law. Now if a person's understanding is not clear as to why they're Muslim, what makes them Muslim, what their purpose in life is, then when you give them the laws of this deen, then they will not be able to appreciate the value of those laws, and they will not be committed to those laws because they don't understand the foundation upon which these laws have value. So for instance, for our children, a lot of times, our youth, we don't give them the foundation. We don't give them the intellectual foundation or the spiritual foundation on top of which the deen is built. And then we tell them, this is haram, and you can't do this, and you have to do that. And they don't know why. They have no idea why. So they constantly, they're wondering, our parents do these things. Apparently they never told me a reason for it, or they really didn't give me a convincing reason for it, so there must not be a reason. For them, there's no foundation. It's very hollow. So it's the moment you turn around and you're not shoving, you know, halal haram down their throat, they're going to do whatever they want to do. That's no surprise. You shouldn't blame your kids for that. That's just, you know, if you don't have the proper roots, how are you going to have a healthy tree? It's just common sense. So the foundation is in the first two ayat, that yatlu alaykum ayatina wa yuzakkikum. And in it, there's also a hint that I alluded to before, that we don't actually have to come up with a curriculum to culture the mentality of our ummah. We don't. Allah already gave us the curriculum. The messenger was given what curriculum to cleanse people? يَتْلُوا عَلَيْكُمْ آيَاتِنَا. He recites unto you our ayat. Quran education. Quran education in and of itself is an intellectual cleanser and a spiritual cleanser. If we're paying attention in salat, we're being spiritually cleansed. And if we're truly understanding what we're hearing and we're reflecting upon what we're hearing in salat, we're being constantly intellectually cleansed also. It's supposed to be this direct relationship with the Quran that is supposed to be the process of purification. And then on top of that, the laws are built and we're reinforced. Our commitment is reinforced every time we come into salat. And then finally, al-hikmah. And we've had several sessions on al-hikmah before. And that would be the climax of an intellectual person. That they learn something valuable, they learn good knowledge, and they're also able to live by that knowledge. Because a lot of times people have a lot of knowledge, but they don't actually live by it in their character. A wise person will have that knowledge and be able to live by it. But to gain that level of maturity, that's the nth degree. That would be wisdom. So that is يُعَلِّمُكُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. Which is why a lot of ulama, including Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah, Imam Malik rahimahullah, had the opinion that al-hikmah refers to the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And it's very easy to understand in modern terms. Where Qur'an is theory, the messenger is practice. So they would see wisdom as the practice of the Messenger, the Quran implemented, the Quran lived. So that, you know, so it's not like they're referring to Sahih Bukhari or they're referring to a book as the Sunnah. They're referring to the practice of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam as al-hikmah, because it combines these two things. It's his practice based on revelation in its best possible form. وَيُعَلِّمُكُمْ مَا لَمْ تَكُونُوا تَعْلَمُونَ. And you taught, he teaches you what you couldn't possibly ever have known. وَيُعَلِّمُكُمْ مَا لَمْ تَكُونُوا تَعْلَمُونَ. This part of Allah's favor is already completed. That this revelation and the wisdom in it, the knowledge in it, the means to cleanse yourselves in it, the means to fulfill the purpose for which Allah created human beings, and to give this message to humanity, you wouldn't have had this knowledge. You wouldn't have had this access. But He teaches you that which you could never have known. وَيُعَلِّمُكُمْ مَا لَمْ تَكُونُوا تَعْلَمُونَ. Then He says, فَذْكُرُونِي. Then as a result, you know, dhikr, remembering, when somebody does you a big favor, then it's easy to remember them. It's easy to appreciate them. And it would be a really indecent thing to do to not appreciate someone who's done you a grand favor. Here Allah doesn't even impose His favor of creating us, or of, you know, or of giving us our health or our status or, you know, any other faculties. He's imposing specifically the favor of sending us the Messenger and having His Messenger fulfill His mission. And as a result, فَذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرْكُمْ. Then you make mention of me. Then, فَذْكُرُونِي. Then as a result, remember me. أَذْكُرْكُمْ. And I, in response, Allah says, I'll remember you. I'll remember you. There's a very beautiful relationship that's being described here. And a lot of times when you and I, we remember important people all the time. We have, other than Allah, there are important people in society, and you remember them. You make mention of them, you talk about them. Sometimes they could be pathetic people like artists and singers or actors. People talk about them all the time. It could be politicians, heads of state, they're in the news. So you remember them and you talk about them all the time. But they don't remember you. They're too big to think about you, right? It's not a two-way street relationship. You know a lot about them, but they know nothing about you, and they don't care. They don't want to know about you. There's way too many of you anyway, so they don't want to know about you. In this relationship, now you cannot remember someone more important than Allah Azza wa Jal. You can't. And here Allah is giving us an amazing honor. He says, you're remembering me, and as a result, what am I doing? أَذْكُرْكُمْ. I'll remember you. I'll make mention of you. SubhanAllah. You know, what an honor Allah gives us, subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He makes it a point to remember us. I mean, just compare that to worldly situations. وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى. But just the idea of being remembered by someone important, just that idea. You know, if somebody even makes mention, if some, you know, some child's name in school is announced by the principal that this student got is on the honor roll or something, he's mentioned by the principal, this child is on cloud nine because my name got mentioned, I'm being remembered, I'm being mentioned, I'm being talked about. It's a huge honor. Allah is honoring the ummah here. فَذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرْكُمْ وَشْكُرُولِي. And as a result, be grateful to me, and be grateful to me. وَشْكُرُولِي. Be grateful to myself. So there's dhikr of Allah and there's shukr of Allah, right? The remembrance of Allah and then the gratitude of Allah. You know, some of the most beautiful things I've read, like Imam Al-Alusi rahimahullah, he used to say, I don't know how to thank Allah for giving me the opportunity to thank Him. Because the fact that we're thanking Allah, the fact that we're remembering Allah, in and of itself is a huge favor that so many others don't have access to this treasure. How much reward a person earns when they truly, genuinely remember Allah. They're becoming wealthier by every movement of their tongue. They're becoming wealthier in the Akhirah. How can we thank Allah for that? You know, for just that even. So it's an infinite loop. وَشْكُرُولِي وَلَا تَكْفُرُونَ. At the same time He says, don't you dare be ungrateful to me. Now تَكْفُرُوا بِي, if you hear a ba, like إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا بِاللَّهِ, الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ, if you hear the ba, it means to disbelieve. But there's no ba here. وَلَا تَكْفُرُونِي. There's no ba. When the word kufr comes without a preposition like that, it means to be ungrateful, to deny a favor. It's still a form of denial, but it's denying a favor. وَلَا تَكْفُرُونَ. Be grateful and don't be ungrateful. Now you would think that's redundance, and that's the last thing we'll talk about today. I mean, if you're being grateful, obviously you're not being ungrateful, right? So it's either one or the other. If you're being ungrateful, that means you're not being grateful. So why mention both? Why say, be grateful to me? And don't be ungrateful. Why? Because it's possible for a human being to be grateful sometimes and ungrateful other times. And Allah is warning us. He's warning us that you should be grateful when? all the time. And don't find yourself in any situation where you are being ungrateful. That's not even acceptable, even a little bit of the time. Because if Allah only says, وَشْكُرُوا لِي, be grateful to me, that doesn't necessarily mean always. It means you're being grateful, whatever you're doing, you're being grateful. Other times you're neglectful, you're ungrateful. But you could still say, at least in some occasion, I'm fulfilling what it says. But if he says, وَشْكُرُوا لِي وَلَا تَكْفُرُونَ, he puts the amr and the nahi together, now you can't help but be in a situation of gratitude. You have to be in that situation. This is why the salat is such a beautiful gift from Allah Azza wa Jal. We fulfill this commandment every time we make salat. We do dhikr of Allah in salat, and the essential part of salat is al-fatiha, and the fatiha begins with the thanks and praise to Allah. Alhamdulillah, that's part of ushkuruli. We fulfill that commandment every time we make salat. So now the only thing we have to worry about is what happens in between salawat. Now that's the only thing left. You know, حَافِظُوا عَلَى الصَّلَوَاتِ وَالصَّلَاةِ الْوَسْطَى is coming in this surah too. Make sure you take care of all of the prayers, especially as salat al-wusta, which some ulama comment is salat al-asr, others said it's fajr, they have different opinion. And another opinion even is what happens between the prayers. Because it's the middle, meaning in the middle of all the prayers. The connection with Allah in between the salawat. Guard that too. Take care of that too. Because you could be watching a movie, oh, maghrib time. You hit the pause button, you make salat really quickly while the scenes are playing in your head. Right? And then the moment you're done, you hit the pause again. Okay, I'm back. You know? You didn't really remember Allah or thank Him. And what's happening in between the salawat is despicable. Right? So, because some people, just, for salat, it just becomes a habit to them. And it carries no benefit for them other than the physical exercise. Salat is supposed to be a transforming experience. So I pray that Allah Azza wa Jal gives us that benefit in every single one of our salawat and makes us a people that truly are grateful to Him and are not ungrateful. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-Hakim wa nafa'ni wa iyyakum bil ayati wa dhikr al-Hakim. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. ولا تقولوا لمن يقتل في سبيل الله أموات بل أحياء ولكن لا تشعرون ولنبلونكم بشيء من الخوف والجوع ونقص من الأموال والأنفس والثمرات وبشر الصابرين الذين إذا أصابتهم مصيبة قالوا إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون أولئك عليهم صلوات من ربهم ورحمة وأولئك هم المهتدون
الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين ثم أما بعد We're up to ayah number 154 of Al-Baqarah The last ayah we talked about يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ And just as a quick summary, one of the added notes I gave you on يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ is seek Allah's help by doing patience. In other words, become qualified to get Allah's help by becoming a person of patience and becoming a person of prayer. When you do those two things, then you can actually try and get Allah's help. And Allah's help comes at the end of the ayah also, إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ That's an ayah, that's the part of the ayah that Allah is with those who have sabr, is Allah's responsive help. Allah is at the aid of those or He's with those who have sabr. Now, the extreme of sabr, meaning you and I are supposed to have sabr in difficult circumstances. Well, the most difficult circumstance is when there's loss of life. Everything short of that is something taken away from life, some luxury taken away, some health taken away, some portion of life taken away. But the ultimate test of sabr would be life itself taken away. And one of the greatest losses, of course, if it's not our own life, it's the loss of a member of the family, a friend, a leader, things like that. So Allah Azza wa Jal takes us straight to that subject. He says, وَلَا تَقُولُوا لِمَنْ يُقْتَلُ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ أَمْوَاتِ And don't you say about the one who was killed in Allah's path, meaning those who died in the path of Allah. And this is already, according to most Mufassirun, these ayat are before Badr, their preparation for Badr. So Allah is already mentally preparing us for that consequence.
Also, there have been some Sahaba who have been killed in Allah's path without fighting, but even just for saying La ilaha illallah, they've been killed. In the Meccan part of the seerah of the Prophet ﷺ, also يُقْتَلُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ, they've been killed in Allah's path. Don't say about them that they're dead. لا تقولوا لمن يقتل في سبيل الله أموات. Don't say about them that they're dead. بل أحياء. Rather, no, they're alive. ولكن لا تشعرون. However, you don't realize it. They're truly alive. The hadith of the Prophet ﷺ in this regard are just absolutely beautiful. About the shaheed who, when he is shaheed, he begs Allah to come back. And that he begs Allah that he may be killed again in Allah's path. And then be brought back to life again, and be killed again, and be brought back to life again, just because of what Allah has set in store for ash-shuhada. And this is why, for all true believers, this the want of being shaheed, the most beautiful kind of death, the want of being shaheed is there. However, at the same time, it is this noble desire that is manipulated by some, and you know, in their rhetoric, into thinking, you need to do what I'm telling you to do, or this cause, or that cause, or fight whoever you need to fight, in order so you get killed, or you kill you. And these ayat are used to perpetrate certain kinds of criminal acts. And we have to, you know, the easiest thing to do is we don't even have to come up with a new response. All we have to do is be genuine to our scholarship, our classical scholarship. These ayat are not, we're not the first ones to study them. They've been studied for centuries by generations upon generations upon generations of scholars, and their studies, it's not like they disappeared, they're all recorded. So when you find overwhelmingly the ayat have never been interpreted in a way by some who claim to really truly understand Islam, then you already see that there's an ingenuine, or there's a manipulation, there's a deviation that's taking place, and it should be called out. Anyhow, وَلَحْيَاءٌ وَلَكِنْ لَا تَشْعُرُونَ. They're alive, rather they're alive, however you don't realize it. وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعِ وَنَقْصٍ مِّنَ الْأَمْوَالِ. Okay, fine, you may not get to the point where you're shaheed, but that doesn't mean your patience won't be tested. Other kinds of trials will be there too, less than that. What are those lesser trials? We will certainly thoroughly test you, بِشَيْءٍ, from anything, all sorts of things. Now by saying بِشَيْءٍ, before Allah says, وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ, it could have been, وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ مِنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعِ وَنَقْصٍ مِنَ الْأَمْوَالِ, and the Arabic would make sense still. We will test you from, you know, from fear, meaning by putting you in situations of fear, by putting you in situations of hunger. Allah can test us in those kinds of situations. But He added بِشَيْءٍ, بِشَيْءٍ, which means any, from any direction, any kind, any form. In other words, you don't know where to expect it from, the tests from Allah Azza wa Jal. They'll come in all manner of, all kinds of fear. And fear refers to, of course, the threat of something happening. Like nowadays, just to be contemporary, nowadays, you know, the 10th anniversary of 9/11 is around the corner. And there's a lot of talk about backlash against the Muslim community. And so, you know, and it's a very real concern. And this is also a test from Allah. It's also a test from Allah. And may Allah keep the Muslims safe and, you know, protect our families and our community. But anyhow, so Allah will test us with any situation of fear. And then on top of that, waljur, and fear could escalate into a state of war also. And jur is hunger, which nowadays you call it economic, you know, hard times. The market's not doing so well, the job market's not going up, the loss of job, the loss of business, the loss of these kinds of things. When we talk about these kinds of difficulties, though there are people who are going through real difficulty even here, and that's something that should be highlighted. It was actually a discussion Sheikh Jazi was mentioning, and I thought it was really valuable. That hunger or poverty, when we think of it, usually when Muslims think of it, we think of something happening on the other side of the ocean. Right? We don't think of poverty and homelessness and hunger happening here. And if it is happening here, we're like, come on, you're in America, it's okay, it's not that bad. Well, that's actually quite insensitive. There's a lot of difficulty here also, and there are a lot of people that are genuinely suffering. Just because many of us have had an easier life and Allah has opened doors to rizq for us, it doesn't mean that this land automatically grows opportunities for this for everyone. This is something Allah gives, and it's not something attributed to a land. I'm saying this because there are some Muslims who have the attitude, if you're in America, why aren't you rich? It's your fault, kind of thing. And it's kind of silly, actually, to have that kind of an attitude. So Allah will test with difficulty, and with fear, and with hunger, which is economic strife, وَنَقْصِ مِنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنْفُسِ وَالثَّمَرَاتِ, and by loss in assets and loss in people, manpower, meaning you, people might get killed, and you might have even loss of manpower. Some even interpreted that as there are people that are there, but actually they're not assets, they're liabilities, the munafiqun. That's also naqsa min al-anfus. والثمرات and fruits. Fruits is considered the return on your investments, your assets, your savings. Also fruits was considered children. Some interpreted fruits here to mean children. وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ and congratulate those who are able to have sabr. الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ those who when a difficulty strikes upon them, قَالُوا they would say, إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ we belong to Allah, no doubt about it. And it is only to Him that we are going to be returned. Of course, all of you know, when do we say this statement, إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ commonly, upon the here, when we hear about the loss of life. Of the calamities that can happen in this world, of the things you can lose, the greatest thing you can lose is yourself, your own worldly life. And at that moment, you make an acknowledgement to Allah, which makes your sabr easy. It wasn't my life to begin with. We belong to Allah. And to Him, we have to be returned. You know, like we say, return to owner. Return to owner, right? You're just returned to the proper owner. That's all it is. And so if one internalizes that, Allah didn't just say, عند الموت فقد. الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ whenever any affliction falls upon them, you know, when something difficult happens, something that belongs to me is taken away. Maybe it's my, you know, has to do with my money, has to do with my health, has to do with my children, something that I put my next to, my whatever, fill in the blank. This ayah is teaching us to remind yourself actually that my is wrong. It's not really yours. You and I are walking around with clothes on our back, and I call this my shirt, I call these my pants, I call this my wallet. I do, just like I call this my hand, right? But it's technically not really mine. It's a gift given, and the owner of it can take it back. So when one truly internalizes, realizes that, then becoming patient over what Allah gives and what Allah holds back becomes very easy. So Allah says about these people of iman, الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ قَالُوا إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ Allah has given us in this ayah a real secret key to sabr. Internalizing the teaching of إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ And finally, for these people, you know, saying this, giving a talk about this, giving a reminder about this, very easy. But living by this is a very difficult thing. At the moment of loss, at the moment of sadness, at the moment of fear, at the moment of difficulty, for one to immediately not just utter the words إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ but think about those words and accept those words and be happy with what's going on, be tranquil about it. It's a very difficult state to reach. It takes a lot of training of the self to reach that kind of, you know, mentality. So Allah Azza wa Jal salutes that mentality. It's a very high caliber person that can reach that. So Allah says, for example, وَمَا يُلَقَّاهَا إِلَّا الَّذِينَ صَبَرُوا in other places in the Qur'an. Who will reach that high status except people who can actually have sabr? Sabr is not something easily acquired. You know? So Allah says here, أُولَٰئِكَ عَلَيْهِمْ صَلَوَاتٌ مِّن رَبِّهِمْ These are the people, those are the ones, أُولَٰئِكْ اسْمُ الْإِشَارَ لِلْبَعِيدِ This is also as a means of elevating them. Those people, meaning they're like high up there and you need to try to get to that point. You're not there right now. That's the benefit of أُولَٰئِكَ. عَلَيْهِمْ صَلَوَاتْ Especially upon them are prayers, salawat, salutations even from your master, from their master. Prayers from their master. صَلَوَاتٌ مِّن رَبِّهِمْ وَرَحْمَةٌ And mercies, special mercy comes on these people. You would think the people who are having to do sabr are going through difficulty. What mercy? But this is the kind of mercy you don't even see. Allah will put a believer through challenges just so He can raise their ranks in Jannah. Just so He can, you know, make them strive even more. Or every little good deed they do, it counts even more now because they did it through a challenge, through a difficult phase. وَرَحْمَةً وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُهْتَدُونَ And those are the ones that are truly committed to guidance. Those are the ones that are truly the ones who live by guidance. Muhtad is a very beautiful, powerful word in the Arabic language. As opposed to those who are Mahdi. Mahdi, the one who is guided. Muhtad, the one who's committed to guidance also. It's part of the meaning of the word. So Allah is giving us this beautiful component of our own guidance as sabr. As people of إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ May Allah help us internalize the teachings of this beautiful passage. بارك الله لي ولكم في القرآن الحكيم ونفعني وإياكم بالآيات وذكر الحكيم السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته